If you think about the end user, the anesthetists, in general, what do you think are the main advantages of using a video laryngoscope compared to a direct laryngoscope?
You have to perform tracheal intubation quickly and safely with only one attempt. Using video laryngoscopy, the probability of you needing a second attempt is less. But I'm telling you right now, if I have one opportunity to intubate the patient, I'd better make it successful. Let me give you an example that has nothing to do with COVID. If I'm dealing with a mother who needs to have an emergency cesarean section under general anesthesia, we have to rapidly induce anesthesia, secure the airway, and begin the operation sequentially. There can't be any delays. Video laryngoscopy will reduce the need for second attempts. It'll give me the chance to get the intubation on the first attempt, and therefore it improves the intervention. If I can most accurately visualize the larynx and pass my tracheal tube in a timely manner, now the peer-reviewed literature may not say that it's faster to intubate with a video laryngoscope, but if I can get it done on the first attempt, I think I can reduce the risk. When I am performing direct laryngoscopy, I'm reaching into my pocket just to let our viewers know. I'm 57 years of age. I can't do direct laryngoscopy without essentially an assistive eye. Okay, I need these to do direct laryngoscopy. The other advantage is in Germany, in Europe, in the United States, we're going to start running out of anesthesiologists in the next 10 years. There's not enough of us. How would you like to keep the anesthesiologist that you already have? How would you like it to make it easier for me to practice medicine going into my later years so that you don't run out of anesthesiologists? Because if I need things like this in order to make sure I can do a safe, effective airway management, your laryngoscope and other video laryngoscopes magnify and illuminate the larynx. It makes my job easy. I don't have to approach an anesthetic with any feeling of anxiety that I'm going to have difficulty with the airway.
Okay, so just summarizing, you would have two main advantages. One for the first pass,
which makes
the whole thing, the whole procedure quicker and safer for the patient.
Yes.
And the second one would be the ease of use for the person that's doing the intubation, right?
Yes, and particularly it also allows teamwork between the physician and their assistants or the physician and another physician if in case of any difficulty. We can actually have teamwork if we can see what's happening.
So the patient safety would be definitely an important topic for the video laryngoscopy, right?
Yes, I believe so. There is evidence to suggest that the incidence of esophageal intubation is half or less of direct laryngoscopy.
You've been traveling and you travel around the world very, very frequently and you're holding conferences, workshops, hands-on trainings. How do you see the video laryngoscopy regarding, is it turning into the golden way of doing things?
In the department that I work in, it has almost become the de facto method for tracheal intubation because it's simple, it's easy. There's no delay in the beginning of an anesthetic and the flow of a surgical procedure. We have a desire to provide service to our patients and service to our surgeons. In order to provide service to the patient, I need to minimize the risk, minimize any stops along the way. To provide service to the surgeon, I need to not delay or cancel that doctor's procedure. Unless there's a good reason. We should take airway management off the table as a reason why cases are delayed or canceled.
Or what kind of obstacles do you see in penetrating this market and spreading the concept of video laryngoscopy?
There's an incredible variety and plethora of manufacturers and devices. And I think very early on, we had trouble making a judgment as to what is the most cost-effective system and the most effective system to use for video laryngoscopy. So what we've had is we've had a flood of these devices. We had the first comers in the market. But are they for general purpose use? I would say no. Mm-hmm. So the misconception is that video laryngoscopes are not for general purpose use, they're for special indications. Yeah, exactly. Because they are expensive, mm-hmm. and they have weird shapes that work on difficult airways, but when you put them in a standard airway, you can't get the patient intubated that easily. Mm-hmm. So if you have a strange shape with something that's special, mm-hmm. then it's only for special occasions. So the answer to you is, you need to make a video laryngoscope for regular occasions.
Which is exactly what we're bringing.
Which is exactly what you've brought to the market.
Yep.
When I first was told, I'll tell your viewers, about this device, I thought you guys were going to screw this up. I thought it was going to be a horrible device. And then when I saw it, I said, oh.
That's because you didn't know Heine. That's the only
yes.
one.
Yes. Yeah. I said, oh my goodness, look at what you've done. You've mm-hmm. created the device with the disposable blades. You've created the video screen is large enough, but not too big. Because you could have made the screen too big. The color and temperature of your light, it isn't just the light. You know exactly what you're doing. When you put a HEINE video laryngoscope into the pharynx of a patient, you see things in the patient that make you say, what in the name of God is this knobby looking thing doing in the back of the throat? And what you realize is the device has high enough resolution to show you what the pharynx really looks like. Oh.
I got it. Coming to a summary of your experiences, we met the first time, it's 7-8 months ago at
yes.
the ASA in New Orleans.
Yep.
You started using a little bit the visionPRO and a little bit more. Where do you see us there? What's the value that we're bringing? Are we bringing any additional value for you?
What you've given me is a tool where I can continue to practice the procedure of direct laryngoscopy in my medical practice all the way to the end of my career. It is an important skill to retain. So in the modern day and age, the problem is that we're losing the skill of direct laryngoscopy, and I can't teach anybody how to do it because I don't have a device to use. You're down around the $10 point, or you probably less in the future. This is affordable to use every single day. A friend of mine in Chicago who sells medical equipment for 40 years says the cost of an intubation should be $12 or less. If you can make the use of the device $10 and the cost of the stylet and the tracheal tube $2, you've got the $12 point. This has been the landmark price going back 40 years. If you can stay within that square, you win. If you can teach junior physicians, paramedics, nurse practitioners, physicians that are not anesthesiologists, you have to mm-hmm. understand that our emergency physicians go through a different residency Absolutely. Without any anesthesia exposure, and they're handling the airways on their own. If you can give them the skill mm-hmm. because you gave them the right tool, then you have done, you have actually added something to medicine. You did something for us. Mm-hmm. Why would I support you unless yeah. you essentially did something for us? Why would I push this to a university hospital unless I believe that you can make it cost-effective to practice the technique mm-hmm. while improving patient safety?
Dr. DuCanto, thank you very much for your time.
Absolutely.
It's been a pleasure to chat a little bit with you, to improvise a little bit this conversation.
Yes.
It will be a pleasure to see you soon again.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks.